Coming up next on Arizona Horizon, we'll hear from the state lawmaker who held yesterday's contentious hearing on long election lines. And we'll discuss how American universities can and should evolve. That's next on Arizona Horizon.
Arizona Horizon is made possible by contributions from the Friends of Arizona PBS, members of your PBS station. Thank you.
Good evening and welcome to Arizona Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. The Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals today rejected yet another attempt to block an Indian casino on Tohono-O'odham tribal land near Glendale. The court ruled unanimously against arguments by other tribes and the state that the casino violated a gaming compact ratified by voters in 2002. State officials argued that the compact prohibited the tribe from operating the casino on land that wasn't originally part of the tribe's reservation. But the court ruled that the compact was negotiated at length by sophisticated parties. The language is unambiguous and authorizes gaming on Indian lands. The tribe's attempts to conduct Class 3 gaming, including slot machines, awaits a separate ruling in U.S. District Court. Long voting lines in last week's presidential preference election led to a raucous hearing held yesterday by the House Elections Committee. A number of people spoke, and they were not happy.
Helen Purcell, please resign. Do us all a favor and resign. I want a federal investigation and a nonpartisan recount of this entire vote. We need another day of voting, okay? We need to count all provisional ballots, okay? That's what we need to do.
No more voter suppression can be tolerated in Maricopa County. We demand that our votes be counted. We demand a revote on June 7th with an open primary. Current corruption needs to be held accountable. Thank you so much.
Joining us now to talk about the hearing and what can be done to avoid similar voting problems in the future is State Representative Michelle Ugenti-Rita, Chair of the House Elections Committee. Welcome to Arizona Horizon.
Thank you.
This was your meeting. Yes. You held this meeting. What were you looking for?
Well, I was looking for answers. I wanted to provide a platform for the public to hear from their elected officials who were part of the decision-making process that led up to last Tuesday's election cycle, and then also provide them with a platform so they could express their either dissatisfaction or their experience at the poll.
First of all, did you get answers?
Yes, I'm not sure they were satisfactory, but we did. Answers were provided.
What questions were answered, do you think, or at least what did you hear as far as explanations?
Well, the biggest problem was polling locations. Immediately the public could tell that there was a lack of polling locations. So the first part of the hearing centered on why. Why did we go from in 2008, 403 polling locations, 2012, 211 polling locations, to 2016, 60 polling locations?
And the answer was?
I messed up, was the answer, basically, from the county recorder.
And we had Helen Purcell on the program as well, county recorder, who has apologized continually, said she made a mistake, said she made a big mistake, and said it was the wrong decision, a bad decision. She also mentions, though, that the state has been cutting funds to counties regarding elections, has not fully funded the presidential preference election, which is mm-hmm. what this was, mm-hmm. and that she hasn't said the state is responsible, but others are saying it and wondering, what is the responsibility of the state to fully fund these elections?
Well, their funding reimbursement has been the same for several presidential preference elections. It's been at $1.25. And so to now all of a sudden say that you weren't able to hold a proper presidential preference election because there was a cut is really inaccurate. They operated with a $1.25 reimbursement rate, which is what they had in 12, which is what they had in 8, which is what they had beyond that.
But again, some county voting officials, and not just Maricopa County, are saying that they haven't been reimbursed, and the county has actually had to roll back and pay for some of the past non-reimbursement. Valid argument?
No, that's not an adequate answer to what happened on Tuesday. Again, we went from 403 polling places to 60. Look at the other counties. This was the only county that had this problem. look at the other 14 counties. They were able to manage with that reimbursement rate.
I know that we had Clint Hickman, the chair of the Board of Supervisors. We had him on this week, last night, as a matter of fact, and he said he remembers saying it. I called him on it. He said, you told Helen Purcell be as frugal as possible because of some of these cuts from the state. Again, is that a factor? Not the main factor, but was it a factor? It sounds like it was a cost-cutting move.
Other counties decided to maximize their voting location. There isn't enough justification there to make those kind of drastic cuts in voting locations. They operated fine in all of the other presidential preference elections with the same reimbursement rate. They never had 100% full reimbursement from the state. So there was really nothing unusual about this presidential preference election when you look at their past presidential preference elections. So why this one took a drastic turn, it's hard to say.
Was it a miscalculation?
You know, I think that's probably a lot to do with it. Miscalculation, not being in touch with what's going on. Turnout across the country has been huge. To not anticipate that here seemed like a miscalculation.
Was this an example of voter suppression in your mind?
No, I don't think this was a case of voter suppression. I think it was a case of mismanagement and not understanding the political dynamic. This is a very important race. This is an open presidential seat. Turnout was going to be high naturally. And so to make the kind of drastic cut in polling locations, there's really still not a good justification.
Mayor of Phoenix, among others, I think he called it a fiasco. The governor said it was unacceptable, called it a fiasco, wants the Department of Justice to take a look because there were so few polling places in low-income and minority neighborhoods. Does that concern you?
I didn't hear anything in the hearing that suggested that was intentional.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not necessarily concerned that there was an effort to do that. What I am concerned about is that there was a drastic cut in polling locations beyond a reasonable. You can understand, you know, a certain level of cut, but this one was so extreme in nature. And it really just didn't seem, there was really no justification.
As far as the hearing is concerned, were you surprised by the turnout?
Yes and no. No in the sense that people care about their vote. It's a fundamental right. They ought to care about it. And when you mess with it, people get upset. And so to that degree, I was not surprised.
There were some who said that they didn't get a chance to speak, they had waited, that they wanted extra time. There should have been extra time allotted for them to speak because so many folks wanted to say so many different things. Do they have a valid argument?
I had to manage it. Everyone got 2 minutes. Public engagement should never be considered a bad thing. I mean, I called the hearing because I believe in public engagement. At some point, there had to be an end point. So we did the best that we could with the time. That's the allotted time that I got. And I think we used it to the best of our ability.
Let me throw some things at you. Your elections committee here,
yes.
State lawmaker, can affect change. Should voting hours be extended from what you saw last week?
I think that is a very relevant policy discussion, and I think that's one that should be considered. Extending voting hours could be very impactful.
Should same-day voter registration?
Potentially. Potentially. I mean, all of these ideas are good ones, and I think that they think there needs to be a methodical effort to look at all the different things that we can do. But we have to remember some of the items are legislative in nature, statute, and then some of them, there's not necessarily a legislative fix, mm-hmm. and we need to make sure we know which is which.
As far, and I know, I believe that one of the people that we had on, one of the speakers, it's a blur now. We've had so many people on talking about this. But they had mentioned that, you know, voter fraud, the legislature's constantly harping on voter fraud, whether it exists or not. Ballot collection, the latest major mm-hmm. issue that the legislature took up and affected. And yet, this seems to have affected so many more people. Does the legislature get the connection? I mean, do you understand that some of those folks were so upset about concerns over voter fraud by you and other lawmakers, and yet this was just a glaring example of folks whose voting opportunity was compromised at best?
Well, I mean, I'll tell you that after Tuesday, I'm even more confident about championing, I think, the bill that you're referencing is 2023, because that bill has to do with voter integrity.
Mm-hmm.
A voter needs to be responsible for voting and then turning that vote in via the mailbox or at a polling location. Yesterday's hearing showed me that voter integrity was what that audience cared about. And so I don't see that those two items are connected at all. I think that the bill is about voter integrity, the hearing was about voter integrity, and getting to the bottom of why we had such few voting locations was about making sure that we continue voter integrity and voter trust in our electoral process.
Okay, but you understand, but did you see how they did make this, some folks did make the connection, yeah, saying there's so much concern over this and there's so much legislative activity, and yet something like this flies under the radar and explodes, and they're still not sure if lawmakers, Board of Supervisors, elections officials are taking this seriously.
What happened on Tuesday?
Well, what happened on Tuesday in general, but just the what seems to be a perception of an increased difficulty in voting.
Well, I'm not sure that's necessarily true. I mean, that may be someone's perception, but I'm not necessarily. We make it as convenient as possible in Arizona to vote. That is something that the legislature, I think, prides itself on. We have early voting rolls. We have long hours. Whether we should extend them is an interesting point, and I think up for conversation. But really, Arizona makes it as easy as possible to vote.
Last question. What is going to come of what happened Tuesday? What is going to change? Your hearings, what will come out of them? What changes?
Well, one, I think people are engaged. They're watching. This next election that's coming up May 17th will be an interesting one to watch. People are participating. And I think, one, public officials responsible for this are on notice. And then, two, I think over the interim, we can look at legislative changes, and you'll probably see legislation being introduced next session.
All right. Very good. Good to have you here. Thanks so much for joining
us. Yep. Thank you.
How should universities grow and change in the coming years? Columbia University Provost Emeritus Jonathan Cole addresses that issue in his new book, Toward a More Perfect University, which deals with how institutions of higher education can and should evolve. We recently spoke with Cole about his book. Good to have you back here. We had you here a few years ago. You were writing about universities. You're back at it again here with Toward a More Perfect University. What should a university strive to be?
Well, I think it's got to strive to do two things very, very well, and that is to educate as large a proportion of the population who are capable of learning at a university, and they have to produce knowledge that is going to transform the nation and the people of the world. That is knowledge which may involve curing diseases, new technologies, and new thoughts and ideas in the social behavioral sciences. So they have to do both research and I have to transmit that knowledge.
So when some say you've got a university and you've got a research university, you're saying you got both?
Yes, the research universities, and there are only about, 150 of them in the United States, are very much focused on doing both research and teaching both undergraduates, graduates, and professional school students. But research is as much at the center of what their mission is as is the teaching mission, although you can never forget that your first calling is teaching your students.
And so, again, some folks would say, teaching versus the creation of new knowledge, you're saying those should be together?
I think increasingly they should be together, because the more that students, even undergraduates, actually have experiences in laboratories or working with professors on research, the more they actually learn. And there have been a lot of studies that have demonstrated that. So the combination is what you're really looking to get.
Are American universities still the envy of the world?
There's no question that they are the best in the world. We're kings and queens of the mountain. No competitors are in sight. So the question you might ask is, why am I writing a book called Toward a More Perfect University? And I think that the answer to that, simple answer, is we haven't come close to the full possibilities of what we could be. So we ought to rethink the university despite there being no external competition, and improve upon every aspect of that university.
Real quickly, how did we get to that lofty place?
Well, we got there by a great value system which defended ideas, even radical ideas. We had very conservative methodologies to essentially vet those ideas. We built structures that were extraordinarily beneficial for the development of knowledge and the teaching of students, and we had, at the end of the Second World War, the federal government come in and sponsor research in ways and at levels that we had never anticipated before and had never existed in other countries.
And so, sounds great. And yet we constantly hear criticism of American universities. We can get to some of the ideas here in a second and some of the concerns. Why all the criticism?
Well, people always like to criticize, and there's a lot to criticize. We can be better, and the critics have often points that are very valid. For example, there's no reason why people who can't afford college, but who have enormous ability, shouldn't be able to attend college. So we should be able to, as a nation, as a state, be able to make college affordable. And that should be a goal of the next 5-10 years, that everyone who is capable of learning at a college and graduating is able to go despite the absence of means. And they have criticisms which are sometimes unfounded, like that there's a great deal of waste at universities. And that, I think, is not really true. They criticize tuition increases. But it really, in many ways, the states are responsible for those tuition increases because they've cut back on the percentage of the budgets of these universities. Michigan, the University of Michigan now receives 7 cents on a dollar of its budget from the state. It's not much more in Arizona, mm-hmm. frankly, or in California. And those have great institutions of higher learning.
So when those say that the costs to go to a university, the costs are excessive, the costs are escalating, that's their criticism, it's a valid criticism, is it not?
Well, the percentages are going up, but if you can go to the University of Michigan for $7,000 a year, and if you get a degree from the University of Michigan, your lifetime earnings are apt to be between $1 and $2 million higher than if you graduated only with a high school diploma, then it's a pretty good ratio of return for investment.
You write that affordability is exaggerated by the media. Explain, please.
Well, most of the time they're focusing on the Ivy League schools that charge $55,000 in tuition, not on the City University of New York, for example, where 60% of the students go without paying any tuition. California is quite similar, and the tuition that is paid often in these states is not very high comparable compared to not only the private universities, which is the focal point of a lot of the discussion, but it is also not talked in terms of the value equation of what the return is on that investment.
Some of your other ideas, you write that it's a time for bold and new ideas. You want a better involvement with the K-12 system, and you write about how we need to curtail our love affair with high-stakes testing. Talk about that, please.
Yes, I think that the Americans have become great believers that IQ tests, SAT tests, ACT tests are actual measures of intelligence. And they are measures of one kind of intelligence, but not all the eight different types of intelligences. So we tend to get people going to more selective schools, like the Ivy League schools, who turn out to be rather boring and very, very similar to each other. In fact, all the quirkiness has gone out of the student body because they all always take the same, you know, beaten path. They don't deviate from it because otherwise they won't be able to get in, or they fear they won't be able to get in. And, you know, poets like Allen Ginsberg couldn't get into Columbia today because he got a C in chemistry in his sophomore year. We shouldn't have a system that relies on these tests the way they do.
So the John Dewey system, the old John Dewey idea of learn by doing, learn by being engaged in life?
I think it's a much better, preferable system, because it also is demonstrable that people not only learn better that way, but they retain more learning that way.
Well, and to that point, you also talk about increasing critical learning skills, increasing skepticism. Talk to us about that.
Well, I think, you know, we're fed a lot, including by the media and by people who are in political parties running for an election, so-called facts. And a lot of our citizens don't know how to discern between what is fact and what is fiction. If we have a more skeptical population about whether or not what is being fed to us is really factual, they'll be able to critically analyze that, and they will actually be able to engage in their civic responsibilities better than they would otherwise.
Was that skepticism, that ability for critical thinking, was it there more when humanities were more at the center of the university? You write that it's time for universities to bring back humanities to the center instead of the perimeter. What happened to humanities? How'd they fall from grace?
Well, I think it's not altogether clear, but part of the reason for the humanities falling from the center of things is that people don't believe that they produce graduates who can get jobs. That's totally wrong, and business leaders will attest to the fact that people who can write well, think critically, and think as part of a group are much more likely to be productive in the labor force than those who just are learning basically by rote in the sciences or the social sciences. The other thing is that one of the reasons the humanities has actually gone down in terms of numbers is that it used to be extremely appealing to young women, and now young women who couldn't get jobs in other sectors of the economy are going to law school, going to medical school, going to all these other places, and they want to major in these pre-medical courses and pre-law courses, not the humanities. So it's the opening up of the opportunity structure for women that has led, in some sense, to the downturn in the numbers.
Interesting. It's almost like Freakonomics there.
There you go.
Yeah. You write a lot about Arizona State University. You write that this is the quintessential example of revolutionary change. Mm-hmm. My goodness.
Well, I happen to believe, truth in advertising is Mike Crow and I worked together at Columbia for a decade, but I think that he is the most dynamic leader in higher education today. He's charismatic, and what he's done in 12 or 13 years to transform the kind of university, not only at ASU in any traditional sense, transform the way in which it is organized structurally, the way we think about problem solving, represents a new model for us to think about.
Well, and he is a charismatic fellow. You write about charismatic authority, and he has that. You write about how he has that. But what happens when he decides to go?
Well, that's an open question, and I think it's a very difficult question. I think what you're going to need is either try to find somebody who is similar to Mike with that kind of charisma, but also there are people who can carry on the idea without necessarily having his charisma, because he's going to have left the institution having put in place so much in, by way of innovation, that the next generation of leaders can basically expand on what he's done without necessarily radically changing it.
But is it a sustainable model for other universities? I mean, constant revolution sounds great, but at some point you got to kind of level off a little bit and sustain, don't you?
You do, and I think that it's a model that is good for a number of universities, but I think Mike would be the first person to say that he's not trying to make every university like ASU. It is a need for a diverse set of universities of different types. You can have the old stodgy universities like I'm at Columbia, or the Harvards or the Yales or the Princetons, and they'll keep on going with their prestige and the rest, organized the way they are. But You also need dynamic change and dynamic leadership, and you're getting that here in Arizona.
Last question. Are you optimistic that universities, American universities, will remain the envy of the world and continue to grow and change?
I am very optimistic if the states understand the value of these institutions to their local economies, to the states, and to the country as a whole, maybe the world as a whole, and the federal government becomes more involved in supporting higher education, higher learning, making sure that every youngster who has the ability can attain a college degree.
All right. It's good to see you again. Thanks for joining us.
It's great to be here.
And that is it for now. I'm Ted Simons. Thank you so much for joining us. You have a great evening.
Arizona Horizon is made possible by contributions from the Friends of Arizona PBS, members of your PBS station. Thank you.